Glory, loving Shepherd. We have prayed in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Please sit down and clap for Jesus. Say clap for Jesus. Clap for Jesus. Cannot clap it for Jesus. Say clap for Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. All right, I do. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Give me ideas, everybody. Pastor Ikonem, where is your wife? Ikonem. Yeah, Ikonem. Or Ikonem's name.
Yeah.
Thank you for your encouragement. And may the Lord encourage you as you encourage others. In Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Thank you. God bless you. You know, the Holy Spirit is wonderful. Yesterday, I was battling with the topic I will preach here. It took me time that my wife became confused whether something was wrong. Because I was pacing up and down the room. I couldn't get a topic. I prayed, I listened, prayed, I listened, until it came. And when the special number was offered, I just went. I said, God is wonderful.
Yes.
And these children began to play. And I said, all things work together for good.
Yeah.
You know my topic? Hallelujah!
Yes.
Something very close to it, but listen, it's a long topic. Long. Seize this existing opportunity of God's promise of rest. Seize this existing opportunity of God's promise of rest. Let me read a little long passage and then read the main verse. I'm taking my discussion from what I'm going to read now. And after that, I will make just 7 points that is very important. Let me read Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3. And verse 1, I'll read 1, then 7 to 8, then verses 12 to 4, verse 1. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1. Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Jesus Christ. Verse 7. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. Verse 12, beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. Why it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, Do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. For who having had rebelled, indeed was it not all who came out of Egypt, led by Moses? Man, with whom was he angry 40 years? Was it not with those whose sin, whose corpses fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who did not obey? So, we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. Chapter 4. Therefore, since a promise remains of entering his rest, let us fear lest any of you seem to have come short of it. And that's my particular reference text. The key text is verse 1, and I want to read it in NIV. Therefore, since the promise of entering his rest is still stands, since the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. Seize this existing opportunity of God's promise of rest. When we talk about the rest that God is promising us, it is after now. We are going to a place God has prepared for us. What is the name of that place?
Heaven.
Huh? As your neighbor, will you be in heaven? Can I see you in heaven?
I see you in heaven.
As you are asking him, what you mean is that you will be there. Amen. Hallelujah. As we go on, you will understand my topic more. But we are not joking. This is a serious matter. The argument is a dare. God is talking about the rest that he will give to his people. It has not come. Even though you start to enjoy it now, but we are waiting for the ultimate. It will surely come.
Amen.
And my proposition in this topic is, since God has not withdrawn his promise to give us eternal rest, we must take advantage of it. Because the promise will not last forever. Did you get that? Since God has not withdrawn his promise to give us eternal rest, we must take advantage of it, because the promise will not last forever. I want to read it again. And even if I read it and stop talking, I want you to take notes. Since God has not withdrawn his promise to give us eternal rest, we must take advantage of this promise, this time that it is existing, because this promise will not last forever. There's a time to elapse. It has to expire. And why do I know that? Come with me to Luke chapter 13. 25 to 27, Luke chapter 13. It's a popular verse I like to think about. Luke 13, 25 to 27. In answer to a question put to Jesus by somebody, the person for it asked the person to strive to enter. From 25, he said, when once the master of the house has risen up and shut the door, and you begin to stand out and knock at the door, saying, Lord, Lord, open for us. answered and said to you, I do not know you, where you are from. Then you will begin to say, we ate and drank in your presence like we did today. Holy Communion. And you taught in our streets like I'm teaching today. But you will say, I tell you, I do not know you, where you are from. Depart from me, all you workers of iniquity. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God and yourself thrust out. When we announce these things, people think we're just joking. This man has started to preach. He's just preaching. Time for preaching. That is why some theologians, my colleagues who are bishops and even archbishops, they preach flowery sermons like this and they don't mean it because they don't believe it. They're just theologizing. Ministers who preach and preach and preach and yet they don't live their life because they don't believe we are going somewhere. People who come to church, worship, if they have time, go back to their homes and beat anybody, quarrel and quarrel and quarrel, and do whatever, live their life anywhere they, because they don't know that we're going somewhere. So they behave anyhow. When they need money, they get it anyhow. They don't care how they get the money. They don't care how they live with their wife. They don't care how they live with their husband. They don't care how they bring up their children. They don't care how they live in the society. They live anyhow. They take their decisions without reference to God. Because they don't know that we are waiting for that eternal rest. This is the problem of society, and God is still telling us today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. Today, the place I read, I hope you heard how I read it, chapter 4, verse 1. Since God has not withdrawn, therefore, since the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. He still said, today. It has not come to yesterday. He still said, it is today. If you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. So, let me make 7 points you need to know if you want to inherit that eternal rest. If you want to claim that promise. Like I asked you to ask somebody, can I meet you there? Which means you are sure you'll be there. If you want to be sure, because you need to be sure. Some people say, can somebody be sure? Yes. The Bible said, you should be sure. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 13, John wrote and said, this is why I write to you, that believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. But that you may know that you will have. Right now in the world, you are sure you have eternal life. So you know when the trumpet sounds, you are entering with Jesus into the rest. Amen. So, you need to listen attentively if you want to enter his rest. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Since God has not withdrawn his promise to give us eternal rest, we must take advantage of it. How? How do we take advantage of this? That is, how do we make sure that this promise is ours? Number one, I think this thing is happening in my pocket. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I don't want distraction. must take advantage of this promise.
How?
Number one, by believing that the promise is still available for us today. You have to believe that this promise of entering His rest is still available to us today. Look at chapter 3, verse 13a. Chapter 3 of Hebrews, where we read. Verse 13a. But exhort one another daily while it is called today. You know, sometimes you read in the Bible, you read it strongly. Why it is called today. I exhort you, exhort one another daily why it is called today. Lest any of you harden to the deceitfulness of sin. So we are advising ourselves, since that promise is still for today, since it's called today, Jesus is today is still available. The promise is still available for you today. So believe that this promise is for you. And that you have to catch it. Still available. You have to believe it. Look at verse 7 to 8. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion in the day of trial in the wilderness. Remember what happened in the wilderness with the children of Israel? They heard the word of God. They disobeyed. And God dealt with them. Because of their unbelief. After 40 years of wandering in the... But the Bible is now saying, God is still making that promise of entering into them. So believe that the promise is for you. Amen.
Amen.
Number two, take advantage of it by believing that we are set apart for God. God has set us apart. We are not just any other people. We are not just any person in the street. We are set apart for God. And that's what he said. In verse 14, for we have become partakers of Christ. We have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast. To the end. We are partakers. Believe that you are one of them. Set apart. But look at chapter 3, verse 1. Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling. Holy brethren. That word, holy. When you hear the word holy, it means something set apart for God. Holy brethren. Can you look behind you and call the people behind you holy brethren?
Holy brethren.
We are holy brethren. That is, we are set apart for God. That's what we are. Holy brethren. The thing we use for communion here, this cup, this chalice. Can they cannot use it in his house to drink?
No.
Can he use it in his house to drink?
No.
Even if there are no cups, can he use it to drink?
No.
But it's ordinary vessel. The only thing is that it has been set apart for use. So it is holy. That's what it is. Set apart for God's use only. But you can buy this type of thing and be using in your house. You have the right to go and buy and be using in your house. But this very one has been set apart for God's use. In the same way, When you come to Jesus and speaking to children of God, I have no time to preach salvation here now. In this, I believe that all of you are children of God. That is, you have received Jesus as your Lord and Savior.
Amen.
I believe that.
Amen.
So, because of it, you are set apart. You are not like other people you are working with in the office or doing business with. You are different people. 1 Peter 2, verse 9. Explains this well. Explains it well. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. And I read, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light.
Amen.
This person, you know, these children acted Daniel. Do you know what made Daniel a special person? He set himself apart for God. He lived a holy life. In Daniel chapter 1, verse 8, the Bible says, Daniel proposed in his heart that he will not defile himself with the meat which the king eats and with the drink which he drank. He refused to eat. They had opportunity to feed from the king's table. This man decided that this food, even though palatable and whatever, I will not eat it because it's going to defile me. I am a special person. When the eunuch in charge met Daniel, they will kill me if you, if the king discovered that you are in my shield. He said, don't worry, just give me water and vegetable. After some days, come and test me and others. And when he was tested, he appeared 10 times better than others. He was living for God. I love it. The song of the children, they said, they know when to say no, when to say yes. When it came, you should bow down to him, and they said no, even though it was the king, and he had the power to destroy them. They said, okay, if you throw us into the furnace, our God is able to save us. But even if he decides not to save us, we will still not bow to you, O King. Hallelujah.
Amen.
These are people who have decided. Why? They know there is a rest waiting for them.
Right.
There is a heaven, a better place.
Amen.
Amen. And that is what they are living for. You can be corrupted by anybody. You can be corrupted by your friend. You can be corrupted by anger. You can be corrupted by what you are thinking. But make sure you say no. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Number three, if you want to take advantage of this promise in order to enter the rest, number three, believe that you are among the people God has adorned heaven for. You are among the people God has adorned or equipped heaven for. That is, that heaven is for you. When God said, I'm preparing a place for you, you believe that you are one of them.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. You know, it means something when you are thinking about something. If you want to get a job, you press any, you do everything to get that job. If you want to go to heaven and believe you are a candidate of heaven, that's the way you live. Because you are sure you'll be there. In chapter 3, verse 1b, therefore, holy brethren, partakers of heavenly calling. Partakers of heavenly calling. Amen.
Amen.
How many people are partakers? You are one of those called for heaven. Can you raise your hand?
Amen.
You are partaker. A partaker of the heavenly calling. Clap for Jesus, everybody. Amen.
Amen.
In John chapter 41 to 3, Jesus was telling his disciples, believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go going to prepare a place for you. That's the particular verse. And if I go and prepare that place, I will come and take you unto myself. That where I am, there you will be also. Partakers of the heavenly calling. Some people think when they die, then God will begin to judge. The judgment is not to know whether you will go or not to enter. The judgment is to prove to you that heaven is not for you. Or hell is not for you. That is the judgment. Otherwise, the decision is taken here, and you know the judgment before you go. Hallelujah! If you don't know, then you are in trouble. That's why you need to know here and live the life to be there. Believe you are among people God is equipping and adorning heaven for. I'm going to prepare a place. For how many years he has been preparing a place? And mansions he called. And after, I'm going to come and take you so that you be where I am. If you believe that, say amen. Number four. If you are taking advantage of you, want to take advantage of you, take it by believing that Jesus has taken away our evil heart that takes us away from God. The evil heart that takes us away from God. Believe that Jesus has taken away that evil heart, that stony heart. You are no more carrying it because you have surrendered it to Jesus and he has taken it away. Believe it! Without faith, it is impossible to please God. If you have said, Jesus, you are my Lord, he has removed your stony heart. So if anything begins to make your heart evil again, say, look, my friend, you are no more. You are no more around. So don't deceive me. Look at verse 12. Chapter 3, verse 12. Beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. Beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. It is evil heart that made these people to disobey God and live the way they like. When people want to be left their own way, they don't want counseling. If you want to cancel, then cancel them the way they want you to cancel them. Then I begin to ask them, why are you looking for counseling? They want to hear what they want to hear. If they don't hear that, they quarrel with you. One lady came, drove so many miles away and came to me and asked me something. I told her what the scripture said. And when he was there, I said, I know that is tough. What I've told you is tough. He came back and said, I looked very far because I know you will tell me the truth and it may be contrary to what I believe or what I think. So I'm swallowing it like that. Hallelujah!
Amen.
How many times have you heard the word of God and you are still living the way you are living? You are living the way you are living. The Bible says, husband, love your wife and give your life for her as Christ loved the church. And you continue living your own way. And the Bible tells the wife, be submissive to your own husband. And you say, it's not in this country. It is for people who don't know, who are not enlightened. Which means God should be enlightened. You can't be submissive to your husband in America. You know you can die. And the man will pack and go. You have that opportunity there, but when you tell him to pack and go, remember the same way he has departed from hell and you are going to hell because you have started to live in hell. I'm telling you, the word of God is true. And vice versa, the man who is maltreating his wife and wants the wife to go. Jesus said, you have no right. Anyway, I see many families all day are preparing themselves for hell. I'm telling you, when I was asking somebody, where were we? Well, I was asking somebody, I think it was here, when we met with the authorities of this Lake City Church. I said, I know the history of this nation. Why is it in their calling they write in God we trust? And the day when you tune TV, somebody was interviewed in TV about what he said concerning her faith. The woman was about to know, he said, what do you think? The woman was dodging, that's the way he said dodging what he said about it. He said this, he will lose his election. He will lose her election. Amen. Because what she said is not what Americans believe. So he wants that Senate office more than going to heaven. We're in trouble. It's a terrible thing. Yet in God we trust. And we say that if you talk against homosexuality, you are wicked. You are not being sympathetic. You have no love. In fact, the Episcopal Church said, it's out of love. You don't talk about it because. And I tell you, so. What is love? What is love? Because people don't understand what is love. God is love, but God cannot accommodate iniquity. So if you know what is love, you can say that. The Bible condemns homosexuality, and the society is approving it. At the time, I was crying. I said, Lord, please, if you come against this nation, America, people will be in trouble. Many people will be affected. Because they are going the opposite way. So the senior pastor here reminded me about the history of America. How they started. They started with God.
Yes.
And people are now trying to contend that in God we trust should be removed. They are going to see it and they are discussing it. Jail! Anywhere. Narrow is the way. And only a few, unfortunately, only a few enter. Are you among the few?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Evil heart of unbelief. Give it to Jesus, let it be taken away. In John chapter 1, verses 12 to 13, Bible said, as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God. And verse 13 said, those who, not of the born of, because of the flesh or something like that, but those who are born of God. That is, the first part is by your parents, and the second part is by who? God. Well, what do you do to become by God? Receiving and believing in Jesus. That's why we call it born again. Because the first part is by your parents. Then the second part is when you receive Jesus and believe in Jesus. Jesus gives you the power to become a child of God, and you are born from above. You are born by God. That's why we call it born again, because it's the second part. So if you are not born by God, and you are just created by God, your position is in hell. Yes, race is not for you. And it is that time that Jesus enters, when you say, come in, I believe you now. That is when he removes the stony heart and gives you the flesh, the heart of flesh, puts his spirit in you. Actually, in Ezekiel chapter 36, from verse 25, follow me. Ezekiel, God told the children of Israel, I will sprinkle clean water on you. I'll cleanse you of all your iniquities. I'll remove your stony heart and put the heart of flesh. water. God said, I will sprinkle clean water. Some people think it is water. When you read John chapter 15, verse 3, you know that water is the word of God. You are clean because of the word that has spoken to you. That's what Jesus said. By the regeneration of water, by the word. Ephesians 5:26. By the regeneration of water, by the word. So, the word of God is water. And when we baptize people, we show it in the name of God. We pour water. Because it's a symbol. But some people, when we baptize them, they say, this is the children I born again. It's half truth. The truth that is that you are doing it by faith. So if you take it rightly and bring up those children by faith, the baptism remains valid. But if those children get up and know nothing about Jesus and live the way they like, even if they were thrown into the church, they are still candidates of hell. God have mercy in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, I want you to understand, as you are living in this life, are you just depending that your father was a bishop, your father was a primate, pope? You are depending on your father. You have no testimony of salvation. You are still going about with your stony heart with which you were born. In sin, God, my mother conceived me. We are born sinners, children of wrath. Ephesians 3. Ephesians 2, verse 3 said, by birth we are children of wrath. So immediately you are born, God is annoyed with you. Until you are born again, then you begin to receive the mercy of God. Become a child of God. I've told you that word born again is when you ask Jesus with all your heart, you repent for your sin and say, Jesus, come into my life. And you mean it. You believe that he has come in. Immediately he comes in, he removes his stony heart, gives you the heart of flesh, and puts his spirit in you. And you begin to obey God, begin to think about things of God. And I'm addressing people here who I am sure have, or rather, I believe, has surrendered their life to Jesus. As you are able, have you surrendered your life to Jesus?
Amen.
Amen. It's not a tract, carrying many tracts in the pocket, but making sure that that tract you are carrying has attained your life to. God have mercy in Jesus' name.
Amen.
2 Corinthians 5:15, the Bible said, he died. Who died? Jesus died, that those who live will no more live unto themselves, but unto him who died for them and rose again. So when you say, I have received Jesus, me, you have said, I won't live my life again, I'll be living for Jesus. Center of your life is Jesus. You have given him the throne of your heart, and you have stepped down for him to ask him each time, what will you have me do? That's what you mean by receiving and believing in Jesus. Once you do that, you are born again. So each day you follow him. Amen.
Amen.
So believe that Jesus has taken away your evil heart that takes you away from God. Number 5, if you want to take this advantage of his promise of eternal rest, do it by believing that by your own steadfast faith in Jesus, you can no longer be deceived by sin. Believe that by your steadfast faith in Jesus, as long as you continue in Jesus, you can no longer be deceived by sin. That is, you have received Jesus. Believe that what he's doing in your life is to lead you never to be deceived by sin. The grace of God appears to all men. It teaches us to say no to every ungodliness and worldly lust. That's what the grace of God Say, I'm living in the grace of God. And you do whatever you like. I say, the grace of God. Grace of God teaches us to say no to every. I want us to read it. Sometimes when you go certain things, some people think, is it in the Bible? I think it's Titus 2. Verse 11. Somebody read it in NIV. Titus 11 and 12.
For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, godly life in this present age.
In this present age. It is for this present age, today, when the promise still exists. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, believe that your steadfast faith in Jesus, you can say no. You can no longer be deceived by sin. Look at 13c. Chapter 3, Hebrews 3, 13c. 13c. But exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Deceitfulness of sin. It is sin that deceives you and you harden your heart. My son in Canada, after preaching, one young man went to the parents and started bombasting the parents. You told the pastor about me. That's why the pastor took every opportunity to talk against me. He didn't know. Instead of being happy that God spoke to him that day, he thought that somebody, because it's the sinfulness of sin. You can't repent. God is talking to you. You refuse to repent. You begin to think, who must have told that man about me? And he deserves, it's only me. He has been hitting. It is the love of God. But somebody else will be sitting there and will be weeping and saying, it's me you have been speaking today. Deceitfulness of sin. Sin can deceive you. When, as today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart like those people did in that rebellion time. Check! Number six. If we must take advantage of that existing promise, we must do it, number six, by fixing our thoughts in Jesus, who is our apostle and high priest. Fix your thoughts in Jesus, who is our apostle and high priest. Verse 1, chapter 3, verse 1. Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Christ Jesus. Anybody with NIV? Chapter 3, verse 1. Hebrews 3, 1. Yeah? Fixing your thoughts on Jesus. The apostle and high priest who will confess. Amen.
Amen.
Fix your thoughts on Jesus, the apostle and high priest who will confess. Do you know what is apostle? Apostle is somebody who is sent. And Jesus told the Father, as you have sent me, so I sent them. What was he sent to do? He came to save us from our sin. He gave his life so that if we believe, we'll be saved. He gave his life for us. So he is our apostle, one sent to deliver us. He became the propitiation for our sin. Not only for ours, but for the sins of the whole world. John said, amen.
Amen.
This apostle. So fix your thoughts on him, because this is the person who came to save you. And he's the high priest. Our apostle and high priest. What's the duty of the work of the high priest? The high priest is somebody who enters into the heaven, into the holy of holies, once a year for the sake of others. But it was then, only one person, and in a time, at a time. When he enters there, everybody keeps quiet. If his sacrifice is not accepted, the angel will give him that, and he will be drawn out, because he has a bell on the wheel and a rope. And that's his officiate, because the Holy of Holies is covered. Nobody sees it. That's what was happening in the olden days. The Holy of Holies, nobody sees it. It's covered with a veil. The high priest enters his only once a year. And that time he'll be wearing bell. So as the bell is ringing, people know he's still officiating. Because if he makes mistakes, God kills him. So the people who have come are not even sure that their sins will be taken away that day. Not even taken away, but covered. Sins covered. It's only Jesus who came to take away our sins. When Jesus died, the veil broke into two.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Bible says, the Spirit is saying that he has entered into the heavenly sanctuary once and for all.
Right.
Clap for Jesus, everybody. Yeah. Once and for all, to make intercession for us. Amen.
Amen.
He bore our sins on the cross. He is our prophet, our apostle, and our high priest. Let us fix our eyes on him. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to God except through him. Hello? I don't know whether you have heard the Roman Catholic doctrine. They say that Peter is the first pope. I agree, he could be the first pope. But Peter said in Acts of Apostles chapter 4, verse 12, remember the first pope. But people are disobeying what he said. Peter said, there is no other name by which anybody will be saved except through Jesus. And Paul explained this very much in 1 Timothy 2, 5. He said, there is one God and one mediator between God and man, and that person is Jesus. One God, one mediator. And some people still ask Mary to pray for them. As it is, holy, pray for us. Holy. God said, only one mediator, no other person. Even Mary, when he went to request for the wife has finished, he said, woman, what have I to do with you? My time is not here. Woman, didn't call him mother. Didn't call her mother. My wife always said to me, hallelujah! Listen attentively. Yeah. So, Mary was among the 120 people waiting for Jesus to send Holy Spirit. He's a human being, but he had grace. He was not the only virgin at his time. In fact, at her time, if anybody breaks her virginity, he's stoned. So, he just found favor before God to fulfill the will of God. He went to the disciples and said, whatever he tells you to do, do it. I have no doubt. And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one! Mary has warned you to do what he tells you to do. And the Pope Peter also reiterated it. And the Apostle Paul reiterated it. Put it clearly. Amen.
Amen.
So, I always tell people, if you want to prove something to me, don't tell me that Anglican Church said. Don't tell me, even as a bishop, don't tell me that this is what Anglican Church said, so we must do it. Tell me this is what the Bible said.
Hallelujah.
That's how you can convince me. So, if you are holding your denomination, my denomination doesn't even believe what you're saying. You will go to hell with all of them. Amen. What I'm telling you, it is the truth. Amen. Hallelujah. So this promise is still standing today. Take advantage of it. That is what we are preaching. Fix your thoughts on Jesus, who is the apostle and high priest. Finally, number 7. Believe that Jesus' word to continue in his, believe Jesus' injunction that we should continue in his word. We should continue in verse 15. Jesus said, continue in John. Verse 15. While it is said, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. When you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. In John 8:31, Jesus said to the people who believed in him, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. That's how he knows his disciples. If they continue his word, leave that child alone. Hello?
Leave it.
3:10-14. I want you to see the conclusion of the matter. Why we are warning and warning. You heard it from the children, you heard it from the special number, you are hearing it, and I want it to be rounded up as we do 2 Peter 3:10-14. 2 Peter 3:10-14.
But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything in it will be laid bare.
Listen, that's what is going to happen. The day of the Lord will come when you are not prepared. Like a thief. Yes, continue.
2:14. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and the speed is coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth, the home of righteousness. So then, dear friends, since you are looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. That's 14.
That is the final instruction. Since you are looking forward when Jesus will come again, and since you know that when he comes, something horrible will happen. This world you are trusting, all the houses you are purchasing, everything, this dollar we are pursuing, is good. But remember that what it will be bought off every property you have. The whole world will be rolled up and burnt. So if you know that the only thing that is remaining is where he takes you to, heaven or hell. So begin to live spotless life. Begin to make every effort to please him, to be at peace with him, because that day will come unawares like a thief. Shall we stand up for prayer? To prepare you always for heaven. To always prepare you for hell. As hell, to be prepared for hell. Many things will distract you. Attraction. Reject sin. Tell God that you will no more compromise with sin. Pray against sin's deceitfulness. Deceitfulness of sin. Pray against it. God is talking to you, brother. My sister, God is speaking to you. Hear him. Let this message not be a judgment to you. Let it be a blessing. A day of escape. his wrath. Because he loves us, that's why he's speaking to us this way. Don't look down on his love. Take advantage of it. Round up your prayers. You have made this heaven for us. And you have called us to be there. Give us the grace to decide that nothing can separate us from your love. Whatever the thing may be, human being, hear mighty God, blessed and mighty God, wherever they are, together for the fullness of the Holy Spirit, so that we believe that His Holy Spirit will weaken our mortal bodies, so that we'll be conformed to His own image. Now pray after me. Lord God of glory, thank you for your word. I want to obey you. But you know, without you, I can do nothing. I need your spirit to kick in my mortal body. I therefore ask for the fullness of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name.
Jesus Christ is a mighty God.